today myself is here to present a lecture. So first of all, myself, Dr. N.K. Sharma, I am working here as a professor in physics at Faculty of Technology, Chandrasekhar Azad University of Agriculture and Technology, Campus Itawa. So today we have decided to deliver the talk on the optics. What optics is? A branch of the physics in which we deal the studies related to the light is called it is optics. And generally two kinds of the optics is popular. One is the physical optics and another is the geometrical optics. My topic of deliberation is mainly concerned with the physical optics. So before discussing in the physical optics, we should discuss something about that what is the light, what type of the nature it have, because it is very essential by two reasons. Because in science there are two kind of the developments is there. One is the development in theories. There are so many theories are proposed. So just to explain this theory, we have to require the experimental results. And similarly, if suppose I develop the experimental science, then we have to require the existing theories to explain these results. So the experimental science as well as the theoretical science, both is complementary to each other. So far as concerned to the physical optics, what light is? Light is basically the electromagnetic radiations. They propagate in the vacuum with the velocity of light. Say it is denoted by C, is 3 to 10 to the power 8 meter per second. It consists of the two kind of the vibrations related to the electric field as well as the magnetic field, which are perpendicular to each other and perpendicular to the direction of propagation of the light. So what is the nature? Nature of the light says that it exhibits the wave as well as the particle character. And its existence of the wave and the particle character is very, very important to explain the various experimentally observed phenomena, like first is interference of light, that is interference phenomena. Second, diffraction of light, it is also experimentally observed phenomena. Third, polarization of the light. It is also experimentally observed phenomena. Fourth, photoelectric effect. It is also experimentally observed phenomena. Compton effect, it is also experimentally observed phenomena. Phenomena of discrete, emission, and seventh, phenomena of discrete absorption. So these three phenomena are explained by considering the wave nature of light. Wave nature. And remaining this photoelectric effect, Compton effect and phenomena of discrete emission and absorption, they required their explanation on the basis of particle nature. So, theoretical explanation of these experimentally observed effects like the interference, diffraction and polarization require the wave aspect, and we know about the wave, what wave is. It's simply a kind of the disturbances which propagated in a material medium, that is called it is a wave. And wave are to be characterized by very important property, either wave number, wave amplitude, wavelength, etc. Similarly, the photoelectric effect and the Compton effect and the phenomena of discrete emission and absorption. So simply somebody will ask that what interference of the light is, that is a redistribution of energy. Means when two and more than two waves are to be propagated in the same direction in a medium, then they will get superimposed, as a result of which at some point the intensity is found to be maximum and at some point the intensity is found to be minimum. So that kind of the wave pattern is to be displayed on the screen. If suppose we place the screen to observe the interference pattern, so at some point the light intensity is maximum, at some point it is minimum. So that is called it is the redistribution of energies takes place as a result of the phenomena of superposition. Similarly, the bending of the light from the corners of an obstacle, if suppose the size of the object is roughly of the order of the size of the obstacle, then the phenomena of diffraction takes place. Means light bends from the corners of this obstacle. This bending phenomena is called it is the diffraction of light. And basically there is no much more difference between the interference and diffraction. In both of the cases, the distribution of energy takes place. But the minor difference is that in case of the diffraction phenomena, the maximum light is to be concentrated in the central maximum and the remaining light is to be redistributed in the first order maxima, second order maxima, third order and so forth. Polarization of the light means it's confirmed that light possesses the wave character. If it is a wave, then what kind of the vibrations are associated with the light? That has to be confirmed by the polarization effect. Polarization means the vibration of the light is to be set in a particular direction when it is to be passed through a polaroid. So this is the effect which basically confirms that light vibrations are transverse in nature. Similarly, the photoelectric effect, when we have to expose the metal with the light, then some photoelectrons are emitted, and when we have to complete the circuit, then a photocurrent is there, and this phenomena is known as the photoelectric effect. Similarly, the Compton effect, discrete emission is very simple, discrete absorption is very simple. These type of the experimentally observed phenomena require strictly the particle nature of the light. So that has to be confirmed that before discussing these experimentally observed effect like interference, diffraction, polarization, photoelectric effect, Compton effect, phenomena of discrete emission and absorption, it is very essential to know about the nature of the light, because a wave nature which is exhibited by the light is responsible for explaining the phenomena of interference, diffraction and polarization, and the particle nature confirms the photoelectric effect, Compton effect, phenomena of discrete emission and absorption. Now I will explain the interference of light in detail. So interference basically you study the Stafford systematically, it is very essential to classify it. So interference is again classified. In two class, number one, division of wavefront and number two, division of amplitude. So whatever the Young's double slit experiment we are going on to discuss, it basically belongs to the division of wavefront class. Lloyd Miller, this is also belongs to the wavefront, division of wavefront class. Interference from the thin films, it is basically example of the interference of amplitude division class. Newton's ring experiment also belongs to this division of amplitude class. So just to make the study systematic, interference is divided into two classes. One is division of wavefront and another is division of amplitude. So this Young's double slit experiment we are going on to be discussed, it is very simple experiment to demonstrate the phenomena of interference. In this we have shown here, it is the light source and we obtain the two light sources S1 and S2 from a single parent source. Why it is needed? Because interference may be required, a sustained interference or the permanent interference we have to require, and there are certain conditions which basically define that what are those conditions which are responsible for obtaining the permanent interference. For example, if we want to obtain the permanent interference or the sustained interference, then the two interfering beams must have nearly equal amplitude. Number one, a very important and the strict requirement for obtaining the sustained interference, your two light sources which are emitting the light waves, or this is the two beam interference we are studying, they must be coherent in nature. Means we require the coherent sources. So the question is whether the coherent sources are available in the market. No, coherent sources are not available in the market. Generally, by using these two techniques, either by dividing the wavefront or by dividing the amplitude, we can obtain the coherent sources. So coherent sources are a very, very strict requirement. If the sources are not coherent, then our interference pattern is not considered, whether it is a sustained interference or it is a permanent interference or it is a interference in which the bright as well as the dark fringes are clearly visible. So these two techniques we have to apply. Either we can divide the wavefront or we can divide the amplitude for obtaining the two coherent sources. The same is applied in this Young's experiment. We have to consider one is the parent source, and in one cardboard we have the two holes which are illuminated by this parent source of the light. So these two holes S1 and S2 is to be acted as a sources which are obtained from the single parent source, and whatever the light is to be emitted from S1 and S2, it is coherent in nature. So the condition is fulfilled, and there is one very interesting relation we have to keep in mind throughout the interference study. The phase relationship between the phase difference, suppose I denote it by delta phi, that is equal to 2 pi by lambda into path difference. This is a very, very common relation. Phase difference is always related with the path difference, which is equal to 2 pi by lambda, where lambda is the wavelength of the light and delta phi is the change in phase difference and multiplied by the path difference. So we can just think of about the point O, that what is the path difference here in this figure. So from the source S1, light rays to be reaches as a S1O, and from S2 it is to be reaches as a S2O. So when we have to subtract the distance S2O minus S1O, it is come out to be zero. So we can reach to the conclusion that whatever the two waves arise from the two current sources S1 and S2, they are having the zero phase difference, or the zero path difference actually. So zero path difference means our phase difference is equal to zero, or the phase is constant. So our condition is to be fulfilled that these two sources are emitting the light which are maintaining a phase locking or the constant phase difference. Now what happened? We have to consider one screen which is having at a definite distance d from these two coherent sources S1 and S2, and the distance between these two sources S1 and S2 is say small d, and we have to choose any arbitrary point P which is at a distance xn from the center, that is from O to P, that is xn. So by using the simple geometry, we can calculate that what is the path difference between these two rays which are emanating from S1 and reaching to the point P, and they are emanating to the S2 and it is reaching to the point P once again. So naturally it is very clear in this diagram that there is a path difference, which I can show by this diagram, draw the perpendicular. So S2, S2 dash, this is the path difference between these two interfering beams. And ultimately that path difference is responsible for creating the phase difference. As already I told that the phase as well as the path difference both are related to the each other. So what ultimately we have to done the simple mathematics, S2P minus S1P whole square is equal to D square plus Xn plus D by 2 ka whole square minus S1P is equal to how much? This distance. So when we have to draw the perpendicular from S1 to, and this distance is xn minus dy2, because this is dy2 and this is again also dy2. So in one case it is say plus dy2, and in another case that is d square plus xn minus dy2 ka whole square. When we have to solve this mathematical equation, we find that S2P minus S1P is equal to twice XND divided by S2P plus S1P, because we consider that this these two coherent sources as well as the screen are having a distance. So these two rays are considered almost parallel. So the distance D is same for S1P and S2P, roughly of the order of capital D. So S2P plus S1P we may write it is 2D, 2 cancel. So ultimately the result is your X and D by D, that is the path difference between the two beam interference, or the two beam interference which I have to consider, which are interfering with each other, they are having the path difference is equal to X and D by D. And we know mathematically that if suppose this P point is to be looked as a maxima, then this path difference is equal to the n lambda, where n varies from 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. So we just substitute this path difference is equal to n lambda and solve that at what distance we are getting the bright fringe at point P. So that distance xn may be estimated is equal to n lambda d by d. Similarly, n plus 1th order bright fringe we may obtain. Suppose we put the n is equal to n plus 1 in this equation, then this becomes x n plus 1 is equal to n plus 1 lambda d by d. and very important characteristic parameter of this interference pattern we can estimate, that is called fringe width, which I denote by symbol beta. So beta is equal to xn plus 1 minus xn, and that is equal to lambda d by d. So it is basically a very very important characteristics parameter of an interference pattern, that is called it is fringe width. The distance between the two consecutive bright or the consecutive dark fringes is called the fringe width, and this beta remains same between two bright as well as two dark fringes. This beta remains same, and that basically depends on the wavelength lambda, and say it depends on this capital D distance and small d distance between the two coherent sources. So this is the dependency of the beta. Beta never depends on the order of the fringe, like this n is disappears in this equation. So we can estimate the distance between the two bright as well as the dark fringes by simply calculating the fringe width. So that is all about. Similarly, to link this P point as a dark point, this part difference x n d by d is equal to a 2n minus 1 is equal to lambda. So 2n minus 1 is the n varies from 1, 2, 3 and so on. When we substitute these values, we have to locate the point at the screen where I will get the dark regions or the dark fringes. So in that way, we can easily examine the redistribution of the energy on the screen by taking a very very simple experiment that is known as it is Young's double slit experiment. And just look at whether this PO point is to be looked as a maxima and minima. What I have to done, we have to calculate the part difference, and part difference has come out to be zero. So zero part difference is basically corresponding to a central bright, then first dark, then again second bright, second dark, and so on. This type of the intensity distribution pattern is to be spread out on the screen, which we can see by using the optical aids like the sophisticated microscope, etc. Now we would like to discuss the very important topic, that is the displacement of fringes. It is analogous to the Young's experiment, only is the difference. If suppose we have to give in a thin mica sheet whose thickness we are not able to measure by the screw gauge etc., then we can apply our interference phenomena. And its very good application is that we are able to calculate the thickness T of the film, which is shown in figure. In respect of discussion, it is very important. Again, we have to take in one important source of light, and these two virtual sources we have to be obtained. Or two coherent sources we have to obtain from the single parent source. So our condition of interference is to be fulfilled. Now, when we insert a small thickness mica film in the path of one of the interfering beam, then the central maxima is now not look at point O, it is to be look at O dash. So this is called the displacement of the fringes. And I would like to calculate that how this shift OO dash may be calculated by using the simple mathematics. So from the diagram it is very clear that the ray of the light which is emerging from the source S1 traverses the two paths. One path is in the air and another path is in the film. So time required to reach the ray of light from S1 to P, that is S1P minus T, is the distance traversed by the light ray in the air. So we divide its velocity applied, so this is ultimate time t1 to required to reach the ray of light in the medium, sorry, in the air. Now the another thin transparent sheet is inserted in one of the interfering beam path. So what happened, the light is to be traversed inside this medium and it will take time, say t2, and that will be calculated t2 is equal to t upon v. So the total time required to reach the light ray from s1 to p is s1p minus t upon c plus t upon v, where v is the velocity of light in a mica sheet and c is the velocity of the light in air. S1p minus t is the path traversed by the light in the air and t is the path traversed by the light inside the film. So when we take this common 1 by c is take common, so we have to obtain s1p minus t plus nt. 1 upon c s1p plus t take common, that is equal to n minus 1. And now suppose our central maxima is to be shifted at O dash, so the path difference s1 O dash plus n minus 1 t is equal to s2 O dash. So this is the condition of the path difference as a result of the insertion of the thin transparent sheet in the path of one of the light beam. So finally, by rearranging the terms in the mathematics, s2o minus s1o dash, s2o dash minus s1o dash is equal to n minus 1t, and s2o dash minus s1o dash is nothing but simply it is equal to n minus 1t, and that is equal to n minus 1t, that is equal to d upon do dash, where oo dash is nothing, simply it is the shift in the fringe pattern in the upward direction. So finally oo dash will be equal to n minus 1t d upon small d. So what happened, that shift is to be calculated by very simple mathematics, by applying the mathematics as already I have to apply the things in the Young's experiment. By simple mathematics, this shift oo dash is come out, which is depending on the refractive index of the sheet, and t is the thickness of the sheet and d is the distance between the two virtual sources, and capital D is the distance from virtual sources or the coherent sources to the screen at which we are obtaining the interference pattern. So now the question is, what is the application part? If suppose OO dash is a measurable parameter, we have the fringe system, fringe pattern, that is the interference pattern, and we have to focus the microscope, then this shift may be noted. Shift may be calculated by using the microscope, that is OO dash, put in this equation, and suppose it is a mica sheet, then we know its refractive index. D is the distance between the two coherent sources, this we know, that is the experimental parameter. And d is the fixed distance of the screen from the source. So ultimately our OO dash or the fringe shift may be calculated by putting all these measurable parameters in the expression, and this OO dash is to be come out, which is the shift. Suppose OO dash we know, then by knowing the value of n, by knowing the value of d, by knowing the value of small d, because all of these are the experimental parameters, I may calculate the thickness t, which is the very important application part of the interference in calculating the displacement of the fringes.